Have you ever heard of, let's say you have a secret against the government or the Illuminati, and people encourage you to get it out as quickly as possible? Because if you don't, then that entity can kill you, and then the secret dies with you. And then if you bring out that truth, then there's no need for the attack because the damage has been done. And even if they do kill you after that, then it almost solidifies that your truth was real. So I'm testing a theory here. I did a video called Cinching Up My Armor, in which I publicly confessed, you know, me criticizing other ministries. And while I was making that video, I literally had something break over me because I was following a principle of confessing that sin and closing a door to the enemy, because I was really sensitive to criticisms of others about me and this ministry. And so once I confessed my sin, then something broke in the spiritual realm as I was making that video. So I'm testing another theory, because there was a deliverance that I did that was very successful. It was fun, and the Lord synchronized everything. It was great. The next day, I woke up and I've just been attacked ever since. And that was about a month and a half ago, a month and a half. So, I mean, heaviness and depression, and, you know, some days you just feel like you're 1,000 pounds distracted. So I'm testing a theory. It's pretty demonic for a company to kill people in order to stop the truth from being exposed, stop people from exposing their darkness and bringing it into the light. So I'm testing a theory. So in that deliverance, I believe the Holy Spirit showed me that I learned something that was pretty critical, and that Satan wants to stop me from saying it, teaching you what that principle is. So the lesson I learned that I believe Satan doesn't want me to teach you is the principle of agreement again, but just slightly variation. It's very simple. I could easily said it in the previous video about simplifying warfare, but it deserves its own video. Amos 3:3, can two walk together except they be agreed? So we started the session. It was going pretty smoothly. I believe it was the first demon that we called up. I believe it was doubt and unbelief. And she was hearing from the demon pretty well. You know, what's your name? You know, do you have legal rights? And then she made a face. You know, there was a time during the question, during the interrogation, that she kind of made a face. And, you know, I've seen that face before. It's just basically you're hearing something, you know, either the Holy Spirit or the demon's talking to you. And so she didn't say what she heard. We just moved on. Okay, demon, are you doing any physical damage to, you know, such and such? And yes, no, where are you at? And the demon started not to be so clear in his answers. In fact, you know, she started getting kind of confused, like, oh, I'm hearing this. And then sometimes the demon just wouldn't answer me at all. And so basically the deliverance session started kind of deteriorating. So I went back. I'm like, you made a face about a couple minutes ago. What did you hear? And I got this thought that this isn't going to work. This deliverance isn't going to work. And I'm like, well, what did you do with that thought? I guess I believed it. You know, yeah. You know, yeah, I guess I believed it, you know. So we renounce the lie. You know, Jesus Christ has already paid for your deliverance, so this is going to work. And, you know, just spoke some truth over. We renounced the lie, and we moved on and was able to cast out that demon. What I believe why the enemy wants to attack me so hard and is because not to let this information out is because it was so subtle. And I've seen this happen before, and I just really didn't recognize exactly what was going on. But it really solidified this point. At that moment, when the demon spoke to her and she believed that demon, it was no longer me and her against her demons. It became me against her and her demons, because she was in agreement with her demons, not me any longer. Does that make sense? So we were in agreement. The deliverance session was going well. And this could be applied to healing too. Why did Jesus ask them, what do you want me to do for you? Oh, I'm blind. You know, please heal me. You know, do you believe I could do this? Yes, Lord, I believe. Okay, so now Jesus and that person is now in agreement. Now, if the person came up like, oh, yeah, I don't think this is going to work. I think, you know, I'm just trying this out. you're in agreement without doubt and unbelief, demon. So you're no longer in agreement with the Holy Spirit, with Jesus Christ, or the ambassador of Jesus Christ trying to heal you through the authority of Jesus Christ that was given to all of us. Does that make sense? It's so simple, but yet it's so powerful. And I think a lot of people, you know, that's the reason why you got to take every thought captive, is because this is actually pretty important, you know, and it's actually carries some heavy weight with it. If you're in agreement with that demon, you are now, or if you listen to that demon, his lies, then you are in agreement with whoever he represents. And that could be guilt, that could be shame, that could be condemnation, depression, you know, blasphemy, mental illness. The list goes on and on. Again, I say unto you, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. So when she believed that demon, it's no longer we're in agreement. She's in agreement with that demon. And obviously this carries a lot of weight. Ananias and Sapphira, Acts 5, they sold a possession, verse 2, and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why hath Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? Why hast thou conceived this thing in thine heart? Thou hast not lied unto men, but unto God. And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost, and great fear came on all of them that heard these sayings. So Satan came along, obviously put the thought in his head, hey, why don't you sell your property, keep a portion back, but act like, you know, you're this big Christian and has given us all the land, all the full price for the land. So he believed the lie. Not only did he believe the lie, but he conspired with his wife to do this thing. So here's the other point. Don't be so black and white. Don't be so black and white. In that deliverance, she was on board with being delivered. I mean, she drove. I mean, she was on board for being delivered. And other people too. When that doubt and unbelief demon comes, that demon is doing all it can to pressure the client to stay. And if that client agrees with that demon, it can stay. You can't cast out a demon that's the client wants to keep. And part of keeping it is you're agreeing with its lies. Does that make sense? I know that's simple, but it's so profound on the same token. She wanted to be delivered. I mean, there was no doubt about it. So she was holy. She was listening to the Holy Spirit. But, you know, 5 minutes, you know, she listened to the demon. It's not black and white. Oh, you're deluded. You're deceived. You're demonized. You know, 1 minute I could be hearing the Holy Spirit. The next minute I could be hearing Satan. That's why we got to take every thought captive unto the obedience of Jesus Christ. It's not so black and white, y'all. Instead of using a broadsword for a lot of your situations, you sometimes you need to break out the scalpel and be like, okay, that's a lie. That's why are you controlling me over here? You just spoke the word of God 3 minutes later, but then now you're manipulating me. Okay, so you're switching back and forth. So we need to use a scalpel a lot of ways. Don't just say, oh, you're of the devil. I'm never going to listen to you again. All right. So hopefully I get this information out. Stop being attacked as much as I am. I know I'm on the front lines, and most likely you're on the front lines. So I want to give you encouragement too. YouTube, I think this is eternal residual income. I can make a video, and then 2 years from now, somebody from Zimbabwe can open it up, be blessed, be healed, be delivered, decide to follow the Lord because of that. I mean, that's a great thing that is able to happen now with internet, and, you know, I'm not sure how much longer we're going to have it, but for right now, it's a great thing. So I can make a video 2 years ago, and it's still producing eternal residual income. Now, anything that's worth anything comes at a price. Like I said, you know, that's one of the verses I use against people who believe the lie that they're worthless. Well, you came out a price too. Jesus Christ's blood, which is the most valuable thing in the universe. You've been bought by that. So you are worth something. So this thing that we do, this ministry that put on YouTube, it comes with a price. It's hard. It's tough. People attack you. People betray you. People come at you every which way. But in the end, it's worth it. Okay? We've seen a lot of Christians come and go on especially on YouTube, and I know in other areas, just because they can't handle it. But You're being rewarded. We're being rewarded for this. We can't see it right now. We will see it one day, and this will all be worth it. Okay, I guarantee it. So just hang in there. Continue to be faithful and obedient with the word of God that you've been given. And God bless you. So hopefully you stop being in agreement with those demons. Be in agreement with the Holy Spirit. Again, take every thought captive unto the obedience of Jesus Christ. God bless.